Carter Page joins us now. Thanks for being here. Let's first start about what you said to Judy Woodruff and then what you said last night in MSNBC. Last month, you said to Judy Woodruff, she asked you, did you have any meetings last year with Russian officials in Russia, outside Russia, anywhere? You said no meetings. You repeated it three times. We just played that. Then all of a sudden last night, you say to Chris Hayes that you, quote, do not deny talking with Russia's U.S. ambassador over the summer at a conference at the Republican convention. That sounds like you were misleading to Judy Woodruff.
You know, Anderson, a great analogy is we, you and I were members of the same health club here in New York previously. And I remember walking by you, even though we didn't know each other. And I said, hi, Anderson. And you said hello. And we, you know, a nice little exchange for half a second. Now, does that to you constitute a meeting?
Well, I guess we've met, but it's not a meeting.
Exactly. Thanks a lot. So, I mean, I will not talk about anything that happened in off-the-record meetings. There's plenty of people in Washington I know nowadays,
right, but
especially
who
kind of...
When Judy said, did you have any meetings last year with Russian officials in Russia, outside Russia, you could have just said, well, I did attend a conference and was in a meeting with the Russian ambassador at the Republican National Convention. Because that sounds like more than just saying hello to him.
It was literally, you know, the amount of time you and I walked by each other and, you know, greeted each other. Again, I don't talk about off-the-record confidential information.
Right, but
everyone
but,
that attended
if
that
if
meeting.
If all you said was, hi, ambassador, that's not a confidential conversation.
The fact that we were participating, you know, I wouldn't even be talking about this if someone hadn't leaked it to USA Today.
Right. Okay, but last night, so you did meet with, you met the Russian ambassador at this conference in Cleveland.
I don't feel comfortable.
Well,
listen,
you did, if okay, I did, last night you said you do not deny it. So you do
I
not deny.
I do not deny, I mean, these reports, which is just totally getting this entire story out of context.
But instead
of talking about real substance, real crimes that were committed last year during the election against me, you know, human rights violations by the Clinton
campaign.
Well,
I've read your letter to the Department of Justice. I'm happy to talk to you about that, but I do want to clear this up because it does appear as if you were misleading. I mean, when you say no meetings, the off the record means you're not going to talk about the details of what were discussed, but you can say, yeah, I had a meeting. It doesn't mean that.
It's exactly like you just said to me. You know, it was not a meeting, you know, our thing in our health club.
So you're saying
you didn't
speak to the Russian ambassador for more than 10 seconds?
Never more than, again, I don't want to talk specifics, but I can assure you I've never spoken with Ambassador Kislyak more than 10 seconds. Yeah, that's a safe statement.
Okay.
Again, I would not be talking about this if there weren't leakers.
Right, it's already been reported out there. There is confusion about your role in the campaign. In March last year, candidate Trump identified you by name as part of his foreign policy team. The next day, you tell the New York Times you've been sending policy papers to the campaign. Then August 24, the campaign, Hope Hicks calls you an informal advisor who does not speak for Mr. Trump or the campaign. A month later, September 24, Jason Miller, as we showed, says Mr. Page is not an advisor, has made no contribution to the campaign. He went on to say, I've never spoken to him, wouldn't recognize him if he were sitting next to me. And then this is what President Trump said about you last month. Let's listen.
I don't think I've ever spoken to him. I don't think I've ever met him. And he actually said he was a very low-level member of, I think, a committee for a short period of time. I don't think I ever met him. Now, it's possible that I walked into a room and he was sitting there, but I don't think I ever met him. I didn't talk to him ever, and he thought it was a joke.
So let me ask you, did you ever, you were apparently, they said early on that you were an advisor to the campaign, a foreign policy advisor. Did you ever brief Donald Trump as a candidate or as a president-elect?
President Trump said it absolutely 110% accurate. I never briefed him. And in reality...
Did you ever meet him?
I never shook his hand. I've been in, you know, many rallies with him from Arizona to North Dakota to many in New York.
Rallies,
you know, which is meetings, you know. So it's
well. Let me ask you about that because you have said repeatedly that you were in meetings with the president. You were in Moscow in December of 2016 at a you held a press conference at the Sputnik headquarters, And you apparently, to reporters, you deny claims that you had never met Donald Trump during your time as an advisor. And you said, I've certainly been in a number of meetings with him.
Yeah.
That implies I'm in a meeting in a conference room around a table. You're now saying those meetings were actually rallies.
That is, listen, if you look at the definition of meeting in Russian and in a Russian context, when they have large...
Do you speak Russian?
Yeah.
Really?
I get by. I can understand what's happening in meetings, and I can get my ideas across, but it's pretty ugly.
So you're saying you were using the Russian definition of meetings to, so do the hundreds of thousands of people who have been
not
to rallies?
Hundreds. I mean, not you know, I've been in smaller rallies.
No, I'm saying the hundreds or tens of thousands of people who have been to Donald Trump rallies, can they say they've been in meetings with Donald Trump?
I've been in smaller ones as well. But
what's the smallest? I mean, have you actually been in a meeting where foreign policy was discussed?
Anderson, listen, they were often discussed in rallies, et cetera, as well. Right,
I know, but you know, if I go to a rally of Donald Trump's, it doesn't mean I'm an advisor to Donald Trump, or doesn't mean I'm going to a meeting with Donald Trump. I happen to be at a rally. So you went to a bunch of Donald Trump rallies.
Yeah, and things like that, exactly.
You gave a quote to CNN in January. You said, I've spent many hours in meetings with him. And then you said, but defined in the Russian sense of meetings, participating in some of the incredible rallies that he organized around the country, from Fulton Hills, Arizona, to Bismarck, North Dakota, to a number of events in New York, and I really got to deeply understand what he was talking about. I think to a lot of people, that's going to sound like when you're saying one thing in Russia at a press conference, that you were in meetings with Donald Trump, that makes you sound important that you were in meetings. And then to say, well, actually what I meant was I was using the Russian definition and I was actually in rallies with tens of thousands of other people.
90% of the students from the university and other media people that came to that meeting, briefing or the presentation I gave were Russians. And so when they, you know, when they have demonstrations and gatherings in Bolotnaya Square or other places, you know, that the term for that is meeting. So I was, you know, using.
But I mean, you're being described on Russian television as an important foreign policy advisor to the President of the United States. So when you say that you were in meetings, it certainly does make it. I mean, if I hear you're an advisor to the President, I would think you would be in more than just a rally in Bismarck, North Dakota.
You know, Anderson, this is where things just get totally misfocused. Mm-hmm. I mean, I described the fact that I was, you know, similarly in low level position, and just, you know, as had been stated, you know, an informal, unpaid advisor. You know?
Okay.
So, I mean, you know, listen, it's just a big distraction from the real lies that are out there, which is kind of going back to the point you were talking about with the sanctions, et cetera.
I mean, what happened? You know, Donald Trump says your name, names you as a foreign, as part of the foreign policy team. Then that was in March. Then in August, they say you're an informal advisor. Then a month later, Jason Miller says you're not an advisor and you've made no contribution to the campaign. And you've been saying that you've been sending policy papers to the campaign far back as in March.
Yeah, I never met Jason Miller. I think he joined kind of midsummer and was.
So did you actually write policy papers and send them to the campaign?
Yeah, I don't like talking about, you know, specifics of.
Because you did say, I mean, you told the New York Times you did on March 25th. So I'm just trying to.
That's fair enough. Yeah. Yes.
Can you say who you sent policy papers to?
I don't talk about internal matters.
But I mean, they are talking about internal matters, saying you were not part of the campaign at all.
Well, I'm not surprised that he didn't know me because he was there until, you know, came over from Ted Cruz's campaign.
Right, but nobody ever came out after Jason Miller said this and said, well, actually, that's not true. Carter Page has been, you know, an advisor to the campaign.
Well, the beauty of it, part of the reason why I stepped back is I wanted to prevent continuing to be a distraction. And I mean,
it's weird that you say you step back. They said you weren't part of it to begin with, which is just weird.
Jason didn't know. I mean, he was, it's an honest mistake. He was on a few months between Ted Cruz's campaign and moving on to another thing with someone else right now.
When Sean Spicer, January 11th, just 2 months ago, says Carter Page is an individual who the president-elect does not know and was put on notice months ago by the campaign, what were you put on notice for? What does that mean?
You know, I don't know. I haven't met Mr. Spicer either. So
because there was a report, as you probably know, in the Daily Caller that the Trump campaign had sent you cease and desist letters after your relationship with the campaign ended. Is that true?
I don't know anything about that. Yeah.
So you did not, to your knowledge, receive any cease and desist letters, your attorneys, or anything?
You know, nothing, you know, nothing specific that, there's nothing that really came up in that regard, yeah.
Okay. I just gotta push you on this. I mean, does that mean there were no letters or you can't talk about it?
You know, no material. I mean, Anderson, this all kind of revolves around large lies that were told against me for literally a year.
Right, but I'm just trying
campaign.
To clarify.
You know, I mean, this is such Spicer, a minor point. You know.
Well, no, but I mean, it goes to, you know, to
but
credibility of the
people.
I mean, Sean Spicer is saying you were put on notice, and then there's this report. If you don't want to comment on it, that's fine.
You know, I have no comment. I will say that a lot of the people I worked with were some of the most supportive, positive people, you know, throughout the entire time. Right up to the very end, and you know that's what matters.
When you
to
say
me.
Though,
I was, you know,
you
look,
were working
you
with
know,
people in the campaign. Though, what does that what does that actually mean? I mean, were there actual meetings that you and other policy advisors had? Was it just a, you know, because back then when President Trump said your name, he was candidate Trump, he was under pressure to name some names of a foreign policy team because he had delayed doing that. Yeah. Were there ever actual meetings or?
I have no comment on that because, I mean, what he said in the night of the election is this is not a campaign, this is a movement. I very much see myself as, you know, a supporter. Okay. That's probably the best definition of myself.
So in July 7th, 2016, you went to Moscow, you gave a lecture at the New Economics School. We saw part of it. Can you say who paid for your trip? How that came about? Was that a paid speech? Was that a Russian organization that paid for it?
I was invited by the university. I was paid zero, Anderson, a big goose egg. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is the stories, you know.
Well,
said that someone told them today that, and I get this call that I was paid $100,000. You know, and again, this is things that are, it's this red herring technique where let's
well,
throw in these
Well, that's why we wanted to clarify it with
to,
you. And because, I mean, obviously the allegations are the Russian government does fund, you know, people who might be supporting their policies to come to Moscow and speak or whatever and gives them speaker fees or whatever. So you're saying you weren't paid. Did
Zero.
They pay your travel?
An economy class.
Okay.
So that was hour flight.
The university.
You know, less than $1,000 ticket.
Did the campaign know, because at that point you were still being called an advisor to the campaign when Corey Lewandowski left, I think at the end of July, he said you were absolutely an advisor to the campaign at that point that when he left. Did the campaign know about your trip to Russia in advance?
People knew about it, yeah.
Because you told the Washington Post in September 26, you said that you made it clear to the senior Trump campaign staff at the time that you were going to Russia, you were acting in a personal capacity, and that they approved your trip in advance with the understanding no campaign issues would be discussed. Is that true?
And not only is that true, what happened when I was in Moscow, as opposed to the dodgy dossier fake intel report.
Right, which
by the way,
CNN has never reported any details of what was in that dossier, nor would I ask you about any details of what was in that dossier.
There's nothing to ask, Anderson, because it's everything about me is completely false and just so inaccurate. You know, this Rosneft stake, for example, a stake which actually was bought by Glencore, company founded by Mark Rich,
right.
You know, who's so long history there, you probably remember.
So just before we get to that, can you say who gave you a heads up from the Trump campaign to go to Moscow? Who said it was okay? Because you said you told the New York Times, I guess, that you talked to senior campaign staff or Trump campaign staff at the time. You made it clear to senior Trump campaign staff at the time that you were going.
You know, Anderson, I don't like putting my name with someone else in the campaign because I've literally been public enemy number one. I'm constantly being attacked thanks to this false evidence. And so if I start telling you names, literally those people are going to get
dozens of calls. But you're saying you did tell somebody in the campaign that you were going, and they approved it.
People are fine with it, yeah.
People are fine with it. While you were there, and this gets to the question that you're going to, Did you meet with anyone connected with or potentially affiliated with the Russian government or who may have reported back to the Russian government?
Listen, I don't know of what. For me, you know, I mean, people are, there's plenty of, you know, intel, supposedly, according to news reports, kind of following what's been happening in, you know, what I, you know, my travels and my communications,
I mean, Russia, it's hard to know who you're talking to and who, how they're connected to whatever. But did you hold meetings where you talked about, you know, the elections, Hillary Clinton? Can you say anything about who you actually met with?
Scholars. You know, I was speaking as the graduation speaker at New Economics School. And so, you know, talking with professors, students,
and were
members
those
of faculty.
Conversations about sanctions, about what the what future foreign policy might be under Trump administration. Can you say what the conversations were about?
General, I mean, these are foreign policy experts. And so, you know, we're talking about that, you know.
About the campaign, though?
Nothing's serious about the campaign. You know, some people may look. I've been going there since 1991. Was my first trip while I was at Annapolis, and I've never seen so much excitement about
back in 91. You mean?
No, well,
oh, back then.
It was very similar. You know, because I think U.S. foreign policy has been so severely mismanaged for, you know, for many decades. That having someone who, or you know, the possibility that there may be some change at some point over the horizon, led to an incredible level of optimism. So
this is an obvious question to ask, but at this point, when you were there, the revelations about the hacking of the DNC was not in the forefront. That was later on in the month. Yeah. So I think it's important to remember that timeline.
Yeah. Good point.
It's an obvious question, though. I mean, did anybody there talk to you about? You know, what they call compromat in Russia against Hillary Clinton, about anything having to do with Russian policy, Russian thoughts on the campaign?
Anderson, not only did they not talk about it then, they've never said, no one has ever said, and no Russian person has ever said one word to me, ever, you know, in the, from, to this very day.
What do you mean? You mean about...
about that, the issue you just raised, exactly.
About hacking.
Yeah, yeah.
And so any allegations that you coordinated or colluded with Russians during the campaign, you deny?
Not only deny it, it's just so false that it's, you know, completely, it's a joke. And it shows how dishonest and, you know, and illegal the actions of the Clinton campaign were. When, you know, John Podesta, Robbie Mook are constantly giving these lies based on these false intel reports by people that were paid and, you know, associated
And I know you've complained to the Department of Justice. I read your complaint to the Department of Justice. It's a little odd, I gotta say. I mean, you're That's saying that the Clinton campaign was targeting you in part because you're Catholic and also because you're a man.
You know, there's a very long list of reasons why they were taking discriminatory action. You know, it's hard to,
hate crimes, and based on your religion and the fact that you were male.
You know, there is, compared to that 35-page dodgy dossier, everything in my letter is factual. And there are, the difference between the two documents is there's a lot of additional evidence backing up all of my claims.
Right, but a lot of the people who ran the Clinton campaign were Catholic.
Well, you know, I don't want to get into specifics and discussions, but there were definitely a lot of evidence, and you know, we can talk. That's a longer discussion, and we can talk about it.
So let's just talk about quickly the investigation. Has anyone from the FBI or any intelligence service or law enforcement service contacted you for an interview? Have you given an interview, or anyone from the intelligence committees or members of Congress?
From the DOJ or FBI or any member of the executive branch of government has ever contacted me over the course of the last year. I was actually excited when I got back from my trip overseas yesterday because I received a letter from, you were asking about committees as well.
Right.
I got a nice letter from the Senate Select Intelligence Committee asking me to preserve my some of my information for, you know.
So, and you just got that yesterday?
Well, I mean, it was dated a couple weeks ago, but I've been traveling the last few weeks. But, you know, I was very excited about it because everything that we're talking about here is based on false information. So even though it's a little bit 1984-esque, that, you know, they want to kind of look at my emails or stuff.
It's a routine thing to do in an investigation, but they've asked you to preserve any documents that may relate to your travels or any connections you may have had.
But, you know, the nice thing about it is, you know, you mentioned there was a brief clip with the Attorney General's statement yesterday. It didn't include the full statement, which was, you know, recusing himself for all investigations related to campaigns, plural. Not just Trump campaign, which is the focus of the the first part of his statement, but open to all elements. So you know, I'm cautiously optimistic that
if you were called to testify, would you testify?
I would be happy to testify, and you know, but I would be more happy if there were. I hope that the Senate. I actually tried dialing the number for the Senate contact. The Senate Select Committee's contact to make sure that they're doing both campaigns and going to look at, you know, the very clear evidence of interfering in the election and kind of using the intelligence community to for political acts to support.
You're blaming the Clinton campaign for that. Do you believe that Russia?
It's clear. I mean,
do you believe that Russia hacked into the DNC computers that tried to influence the U.S. election?
I don't know anything about that. So
you know that the Clinton campaign tried to subvert influence the intelligence community, but you don't know. You can't say whether Russia tried to influence the U.S. election, even though the entire intelligence community says that happened.
Well, it's interesting. And even Donald Trump seems in my letter. You know, it's another political stunt, in my view. And if you read, Appendix Z of my letter.
Because someone listening to this is going to say, "Look, you're a guy who has business dealings in Russia. You need to make them. I mean, that's how you make a living. And so it's understandable you wouldn't want to be publicly saying that Russia was hacking into the U.S. But can you really sit here and say you don't have any belief, or you can't even imagine that Moscow might do that?
I don't imagine I don't think about those things, Anderson. All I know is that
You're telling me you spent a lot of time in Russia and you don't think about what Russian intelligence is capable of? You're telling me you don't carry a second phone when you go to Moscow because you know that they're going to hack into your phone? Listen, everybody who goes to Moscow does that. Do you do that?
You know what?
Do you do that?
I do have a second phone.
Okay, so you carry a second phone when you go to Moscow because you know Russian intelligence is likely to hack into your phone, but you can't imagine that Russian intelligence would hack into the DNC?
I didn't say that. What I said is
a second phone in Russia, I got to tell you, you should, because you're the only person I've ever met who does business in Russia and doesn't do that.
Well, like I just said, I do have that. Okay. You know,
so you're concerned about hacking. Them hacking you, or listening in on you?
No, I'm not. That's not my concern. You know, listen, I think what you have is, if you read through that Intel report, I actually have a good analysis of that in my letter.
Appendix B talks about that. Your legitimacy on this, though, your credibility on this, does seem under question if you're completely unwilling to look at anything Russia may or may not have done, to even entertain the notion that Vladimir Putin would be capable. I mean, I read some quote you read during your speech in Moscow. I wish I had it in front of me. It was basically, it's a quote by Vladimir Putin, which says, here it is. He said, "We never meddle in the internal political affairs of other countries, unlike the U.S. Do you believe Vladimir Putin?
I think that was a conversation he had with Fareed Zakaria. But
you read the quote out. Do you believe that quote, that they don't meddle in the internal political affairs of other countries?
I think what he's saying, or the point I was trying to make, is that I made very clear that I was not there as part of the Trump campaign. Right. I was there as a private citizen.
Right. I'm just wondering, do you believe that Russia meddles in the internal political affairs of other countries?
I don't know anything about that. All I do know
you
is
you don't know
reading
anything
that,
about that?
Listen, if I read that, based on that Intel report, it's all politics. And if you read Appendix
B, I got to jump in here. I only have an undergraduate degree, so I'm not as educated as you are. But I've studied Russia and the Soviet Union a fair amount.
Yeah.
You honestly can say, you have a PhD, right? You honestly can say you don't know anything about whether Russia meddles in the internal political affairs of other countries?
I'm in the context of my life, which, you know, all this defamation approach by the Clinton campaign to drag my
name. You're not making sense. Yes or no? You can just tell me, yeah, I do not believe that Russia ever meddles in the internal political affairs of other countries, or yes, I do believe they do.
Listen, they may, I think all countries, you know, or certainly the U.S., if you look at what happened in Ukraine, right, on the Maidan
Revolution.
To change
it to, yes, the U.S. meddles in the internal, of course, so, the CIA
so,
has done
so
this
we're
for
equivalent.
Decades.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, I think that's a fair statement.
All right. Carter Page, I do appreciate you coming in and talking
Great
to
us. Great to see you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.